Okay, so good afternoon and thanks for coming. I'm Diego. I am a PhD. I was a professor at the university, but then I quit. I quit a tenure track professorship to run Biicode. That's what I'm doing now. So the outline of the talk is first, I'm not talking about dependencies. I'm talking about the build system we are using, and we are using cmake. So initially we tried to make our own build system, and then we decided to go for cmake. So the first part will be about this thing. Then I will go to dependencies, publishing things to our cloud, and what kind of tags are we using. Then I had planned a small example, a couple of demos, depending on the time I'll do it or just leave them as an exercise. And the most important thing for me is that in some sense we have hit a limit because of adoption, technical issues. So we are already planning a new product, independent one. It's called, code name is Packet. We think it will overcome many of our limitations. So for me, the most important thing here is not, I'm not trying to sell you Biicode. Okay, and come on, it's fantastic, you use it. What I'm trying to obtain here is your feedback of what should we done for the next one. So what actually you need to use a tool like this. So this is a workshop, so I am going to start with some code. You have it here in my GitHub account. It's DRODRECPP now. So I just clone the code. Okay, so just some files. There's only one file here, actually with a known extension. It's a very complicated one. Okay, so this is enough for Biicode to build something. We just need source code files to build something. So what I'm doing here is to start a project. What is this L option? One of the things we failed in the past, we had a very, say, strict layout folders. So our users were complaining, hey, why can I have the layout I want for my projects? And this L means, okay, you can have your own layout, and without parameters, it means that you can have source code at the root of your project. So this is actually what I have here. This command will create some auxiliary temporary folder with stuff inside, but you can just ignore from your source control tool. And now I can just build the project. It will take my defaults. In this case, I'm running in Windows for a reason. Just hate me if you want because of having Windows in Mac, but I have my reasons. So this works exactly the same in Linux, in Mac, and in Windows. Okay, so the same process, the same building, everything. Okay, so I got here my binary build, and I can run it, fine. Okay, let's proceed, and then I have some other files. Okay, I'm going now to build a slightly more complicated. Let's move the files with an unknown extension to a known one. The say body, the say head, the header, and then also I have a main. Okay. So, what do I have here? It is a very simple function, the declaration, the body of the function, and then I also have main. The output is exactly the same as the other one, but now I'm using that function there. So I just can build the project, and I will get another binary here. It's called this one. Okay, so up to now I've built two binaries, two executable binaries. Okay, what happens with libraries? Let's move. I have another file here. It's called bi. Let's move it to a known extension. Okay. Bi is simply just another main with another message. Okay. So now I can build it. Right. Sorry. And now you can check from the output there. It's in red, maybe it doesn't read very well. But now a library is being built. Okay. And two executables, two X's. Do you understand X's? If I say X's, it's fine. Two X's are being built, and they are automatically being linked with the library. Okay. So I can just run also the bi binary. And it will work. Okay.
So how did it decide to build a library then?
Sorry?
What caused it to build a library then?
Yeah, that's what I'm going to explain here. Yeah. So what actually Biicode is doing, we are doing some file source code file analysis. So when a user put some source code files there, we analyze two things. First, we are looking for explicit dependencies. Explicit dependencies come from include directives. So every time you get an include directive, you know that the main file depends on the hello header. It's that simple. The most complicated part of it is the implicit relationships. For example, in this case, we have the hello headers needs the hello CPP body to be built with it. Okay, so the blue arrow over there also has to be detected. So what we do here is we have our own parser. We check just for symbols, classes, methods, signatures that matches between the headers and the bodies. It works pretty well for most cases. Especially C++ is quite, if you do C++, it has a very good rate of detection. But if you have, for example, macros like the one in the right, it's going to be a nightmare. If you have like a lot of global variables, preprocessor, complicated structure, it's going to be very difficult to automatically detect your relationships, your dependencies between files. Okay, so what we have here is we have some commands that let you inspect this dependencies graph between files. And there is also a way to change it. I mean, if you are not satisfied, if something failed, you can just define in your configuration file what dependencies are between your files. Okay. So when you have the relationship, the dependencies between files, then you can deduce the build you want to do. For example, in this simple case, it seems reasonable that you have a main there, you want to be to build an exe, and then you have two files that have to be linked together to that main CPP file. Okay, so this is an oversimplification of the build process. But you can automatically generate a cmake file that defines this. Okay. Actually, the process is more complex, of course, and we have something like this. For every we call them block, is not a package, it's not a library, it's like a set of files defining test, defining library, defining. So we call them a block. Inside a block, we have different targets. We have defined the upper one, this one, the block target, is an interface one. Do you know how many of you use cmake? Yeah, do you know interface targets? So we use this target just for collecting properties. So if you know that all the targets of your block are going to use C++ 11, for example, you can just set the property to the B block target. And all the other targets will just inherit the property. Then we have also a library. So the files that are common between several X's, then you group them all together in the library. and you build a library. This can be an actual library, or it can be an interface library, of course. If the typical example is a header-only library, of course. And then you have as many access, as many main files, many functions are found in your files. So you can here have a main one, another one, and the name of the target is just the name of the file with that syntax. So we can check here if you want to have a look to the variables that are being defined for your advantage. Is inside the B folder, you get this file. Okay, and in this file, you have all the variables defined. For example, you can see the blib sources are the files that are building the library. If you are not happy with that, you can remove them with cmake syntax and then put them in another executable you want. Okay. You have the blib type. If you want to force it's going to be a shared library, static library always, you can do that. It's better not to do that, of course, because then the user can decide. But you can do it, of course. You can see the dependencies of the library. Here you can see that it depends on the interface target, the one we defined here. Okay. You can see also which system headers you depend on. In case you want, for example, to do extra check-in, you can check if you have math there. For example, you know that you have to link with the math library, so you can use that variable for that. And also you have some include paths in case you have some alternative include the directories. Yeah.
So would you modify this file or would you override those variables?
You override the variables inside your own cmake.
Okay.
Yeah. So I will show the cmake right now, and I will show you how to modify the variables and to use them.
Okay.
Okay. And if the question is if we modify this file or we just override the values of this variable in another file. So this file I'm showing right now is generated and it is overridden every time. So what you do is in your own cmake list file inside your project, there you override the variables you want. Okay. So and then in the same file you have the access you're building, and then the same specification for every X target you are building here. So if you have any doubt, you can read this file and play with the variables inside your own project. We can see here.
So do you get the translative closure of header files that you include?
Yeah.
For instance, in that system. So if X includes Y, you'll see X and Y, or will you just see X?
You get the transitive closure, of course. Yeah. In terms of target, we build the transitive closure of all the files you are depending on, and then we group in targets, in cmake targets, and the dependencies in cmake targets are handled by cmake. But we first, the question was if we are building the transitive closure of the files we are depending on, and yeah, and the answer is yes. Here are the same for all the executables we are building. So here in your project you have the cmake list. This is the file you can modify. Okay. So I will do it in a few minutes. Just first I will show you. Okay. Here we have defined some targets. We can play with these targets a little bit more at the high level. For example. Let's think that two of these targets, the hello and the bye one, are actually tests. I want to run them as tests. Okay, so this can be easily done in the configuration file. So there is a biicode.conf configuration file there with many options, and one of them, for example, is the test. If I declare here the file's names or a pattern is also valid here. Now I can if I clean the project, clean mix means remove everything temporary and build from scratch. Okay, I can build. And now I will get only the library and the main, the first one, the one that doesn't depend on anything. And these two targets are actually run, actually build and run when I run Btest. So I'm playing a little bit with the targets at a high level. Okay, but for most other cases, we are using cmake. So if you want to change something of the build, use cmake. For example, let's say, okay, you're building a static library, but I want to build a dynamic one. Okay, so cmake has several ways. We can define, for example, here in this file, I can do assign the library here, to tell that it's going to be static, but cmake has a typical way that is with build seret libs to on, and that will override the default of static libraries. So if I the options I can pass to bconfigure are exactly the same as the cmake options. So it will understand cmake syntax and pass it to cmake. So now I can build. And here I have my DLL seret library. I can run the test. And they will link against the, right? Okay, and they will link with the shared library, and they will run also. Okay. Now, for example, one of the things users told us, okay, I don't like the name of the, because actually the name is something like that. To run, you know, the name is composed by the user, the block, and the file name, and that's too long. So what happens if I want to use my own output name? Use cmake. In cmake, you can just assign properties to any target. We have the, for example, the target for the hello main is called that way. Hey. So I can just write this for the hello target, and I can write this for the by target. So let's clean the project and build again. And now you can check. Wait, sorry. I have to ask. They are defined as test. They are. Now, you can see there, now the output are exactly the same. Okay, now I have here a file with C++ 11. Of course, if I try to build it, I'm going to have trouble, because here I have some C++ 11 syntax. So what I have to do is to tell in cmake that I am using C++ 11. That can simply done with this. I'm going to assume that I'm going to use C++ 11 for the whole block for this example. So B block target, interface. Okay, so actually it should run now. Here we are. Okay, any question about the build system? We know it predates typical build of the users, and that's not a good thing. We know it, and we are working to solve it, of course. So, but this is the way it is. Now, I feel that it's very, very, very handy for rapid prototyping I mean, just to play in Stack Overflow, I just open a B and start to mess because I don't have to write any configuration file, any cmake, anything. So for new projects, it's quite useful. In fact, we have some customers paying for us because they don't depend on any libraries. I mean, they are using for their own projects, new projects, everything. So for building things from scratch, it's fine. Okay, it's not so fine for building something you are already working on. So, any question about the build system?
You guys overwrite cmake lists, or does that get, so that doesn't get overwritten anymore?
No, the cmake list is not being overwritten. In fact, you can just the question is if we are overwriting the cmake list inside the user project. We are not. We are just using it. In fact, if you want to maintain your own build independent, we have a variable here, so you can do this. If Biicode, do this, right? Else, your other thing. So you can maintain your own cmake stuff over there, and we won't interfere. We have also define for if you want to use something in source code, you can check if dev Biicode, and it will also work. Okay, so now the nice part about the this build system is that we can just I can just publish what I've done. So if live demo effect doesn't kill me, okay, it works. So what I've done here is my code and the meta information, the dependencies between files and all that stuff, has gone to the server. The server is here. This is my profile. And if I go to the CPP now block, I will be able to navigate. I will be able to navigate the source code. I will be able to check the dependencies and so. Okay, so here is my source code. So now, if I go home, a colleague of mine or another person in the world can just reuse what I've used, what I've developed here in a new project. I'll show you. Okay, so I've moved one level up, and I'm going to start a new project, different one. Let's call reuse, for example, is going to be a simple one. Oops. Maybe I think I didn't save. It's fine. It's fine. Let me check because it wasn't saved. Yeah, it's in the. It is fine in the server. So I'm going to move to this new project here. And what I'm going to do is, I'm going to use the same file I did in the past, the Hello 11 example, and I'm going to put it in the new. So I'm going to close this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. Most of them, but the new one. Okay. Now, what happens if I try to build the new project? Of course, it's going to fail because it's not going to find this header here. I can check with the bdeps command that something is missing. Okay, I'm missing that header. So I could check here. I navigate. I find it. Someone told me. And I check that, okay, I want to use this header. So all I have to do is I go to my file and just write this full path header. There is a way to don't do it, but for now, I will run with this option. So if I check my depths, I will check this still unresolved, but now I have a way to map it to the server version. So what I'm doing here is I will do bfind it will retrieve the code, it will configure everything, so I will be able to build my project. Okay. Not, for example, that for this project, I haven't needed to define that it is C++11. Why? Because it is already defined in the other project, and I have just inherited that property, okay, because everything is being built in the same project. So the properties that are transitive, like this one, is being inherited. So I just link to say header, and I got the properties also in this new build. So this is done. So what happened here, when I published the source code with meta information, right? Actually, we are publishing also the source code. A lot of users ask us if they could just retrieve code from GitHub or Bitbucket or whatever. The answer is maybe we could, but at the beginning, we store meta information per file. So we have a table in our database, so we store meta information of each file. Storing the source code was obvious, was trivial. Okay, so we just go for it. And also, some of our customers, they are not using Git. They are using Subversion, they are using even CVS. So we couldn't force, we didn't want to force to depend on Git. In this case. So we are actually storing the meta information and also the source code in Biicode right now. So the cool thing here is that you don't have to define any library, any packaging, anything, you just upload everything. And when other users, just like I did, depend on your code, what is happening? It goes there, it builds the transitive closure, but only the files you are depending on. For example, in this case, there are several mains there, okay? They are not being retrieved. I only get in my example, the say header and the say CPP file. The other files, I don't need them for building my project. So actually, I only get the files I need, and they are linked in my project. And in the same way, I define a cmake file there with variables, and those variables are loaded. And they are used to build the project. Exactly the same as before, but now with dependencies, with all the things I'm depending on. So this has the beauty that I can, of course, now publish again the code I've made. And this is a virtuous circle you can depend on, and you can depend on, and it's quite useful. Every time you just build the transitive closure of the files you are using. I will show you a demo afterwards. I will build some code in Arduino, for example, from a project that use many other dependencies that are not buildable in Arduino. So.
What sort of resources? What do you mean by, because I use Arduino for my students and stuff.
Yeah.
So what are the dependencies? You mean other libraries that are more like C?
No,
libraries or?
No, you can just build, sorry, the question is if what kind of libraries, what are we doing to handle source code from a C++ desktop project to Arduino projects? It's more or less?
Yes. Yeah, I can understand the C++ stuff, but the Arduino is a bit different.
The Arduino code is different. The Arduino code is C++.
It's C, yeah.
It's C++.
No, no, no. The
ADR GCC
is.
Yeah, but the ADR GCC doesn't have the, for example, the STL or something like that. It won't compile STL, of course, Arduino. But you can have classes, and you can have part of C++ features.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. So actually, if you build portable, simple C++ in a project, a desktop project with dependencies, like I will do afterwards, if you want to depend on just those files with the algorithm in Arduino, you can do that.
Okay.
Because you extract just the files, And the transitive dependencies of those files do not include graphics, do not include testing, all the things that won't build in Arduino. You will not get them in your Arduino project.
So you don't use it well. So you can't use it with the Arduino, you know, the silly.
No, with the with no.
So it's pure, like doing pure AVR code.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so the question is if you could use that in the Arduino environment. Yeah, it is very simple and limited, and no, you will not be able. No, you will not be able to use because in the Arduino environment. So about the absolute path for the include, you can avoid that. You can map in your Biicode.conf configuration. You can map with patterns or with names. Okay, this header is going to be found in this place, and you can just map it. So then in your code you will just write, okay, I want to include say.h or any other thing. Okay, so this can of course can be done. So this when I published the first time here, I publish as a dev tag. Dev is for development, so you can change it. Every time you publish as development, as developer, it will be overwritten. Okay, so I will just do that. I will move to the other project, and I realize, okay, I don't like this output. I'm going to do a beautiful output with some extra things here. Okay, so I moved to the other project, and now I publish again. If you read the message here, it's telling, okay, I'm using the dev tag, and dev tag is overriding the previous thing. So this propagates automatically. If I move to the other, to the one I'm reusing, and I build again, it will retrieve the new dependencies, and it will build with them. So now I get the beauty output here. Okay, this is very. We build that because the users were complaining that they were creating so many versions. For example, when you are trying multi-platform code and you want to try in Mac, Linux, and Windows. This is very, very useful because you just publish to Biicode and upgrade in the other computers, and you don't have to clutter your source code history with a lot of commits, for example, that then you will have to squash or everything you just publish. And when you are ready in all the machines, then you commit to source control. Okay. So, of course, there is a way to. There is a way to freeze things, okay? So I move to the previous project, and I publish again, but now I will tell that it's going to be stable. Okay, stable means freeze it. You have to freeze it, it's not going to be modified never again, okay? So now, it is frozen. Let's say that, oh, I realize that I want another output here with more characters. Now that it is published, I can check the diff, and it will diff against the last published version over there. And I can publish again, of course. Now I'm getting a second version. I will check in the web that now here we have two versions. Of course, we have the stable one, and we have the new one with the dev tag. This is going to be overridden if I publish again, of course. And I can check that. Here it will have the last modifications with a lot of characters. So how can I use different versions in the other project? So in the other project, I also have this configuration file here. When I run bfine, it put here in requirement section, it put Diego CPP now the version number 0. Okay. So the first thing I can do to upgrade my dependencies is just to modify this number. I want to use version 1. I change the number. I run my build. And then I get the new output. Okay? If I change back to the old version, okay, we also build like an intelligent updater. So if you want to check for compatible updates, compatible means that it will check that upstream you don't have conflicting versions. Okay, so you can run bfine with the update option, and if it finds versions, it will automatically update them. Okay. Yeah, that's it. So actually, when we publish again as a stable here, we are doing a crazy thing, probably too academic. I mean, we are doing the diff exactly the same as Git. We are diffing file by file, and we are storing just the delta, full files, okay? But the delta. So for the version number 1, we only modified one file, right? So we only have one file modified in the new version. That allows us to make crazy things, and they are possible, maybe not wanted, but they are possible. For example, we can mix upstream versions, different files from different versions. Yeah. If they are not connected, imagine you have the initial version here, you have some files, you have a library depending on those files. Okay. Then the original author make many publications, improves a lot. Maybe those files are not found anymore. There are new other files in the library. Okay, and then you have another user depending on the new version. Okay, there is no way you will be able to build that setup because you are getting conflicted version. But if those files actually are not colliding, they are not connected with file dependencies, you can build them. And actually, we can do it. We have tested. Different thing is that you want that behavior, but you can do it. Yeah, I've checked diff. Yeah.
Will it actually solve for the cases where you have a library that has one dependency and it requires a certain version, and then you specify in your library a version, but you don't, or you specify the same library, but you don't specify a version? Will it try to solve like what versions are actually possible?
Yeah. Sorry. The question is if we are checking if the, those conflicts in advance. Is that the question?
No. Is it possible for it to solve what version? Like, so if you have a bunch of dependencies, and certain dependencies require certain versions. If some of them don't necessarily specify a version, like will it go in and try to solve what is the best version to use based upon the other dependencies that's used throughout the whole project?
So the question is that if the dependencies are not specified, if the system can actually look for a compatible solution for it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of. So actually what we are doing in the find process is we are analyzing is an NP-hard problem we are solving in the server. So we are analyzing all the possible solutions, of course, with a heuristic.
Using a SAT solver?
Yeah, we are using, one of the founders of our team is called Pablo San Segundo. He's a chess grandmaster. He also developed the best maximum click algorithm. Now it's called he's using bit sets to solve it, and I think up to today is the fastest solution in the world. So the dual of the maximum click is a sad problem. So he applied a lot of his knowledge to solving this sad problem in the server. But in any case, that's too academic. We have brilliant papers in top journals. We haven't hit any case yet when we need it in practice in Biicode. So it's there. Maybe when we have millions of libraries there with very complicated dependencies, then we'll start to hit that necessity. But for us today, no, we don't need it. We will run just with a greedy algorithm.
Do you do anything with versions associated with, you know, what compilers and what versions of those compilers that code will actually build with?
Yeah. The question is that if we are managing the versions that works with certain compilers in certain systems, so all the meta information associated to the libraries there, if we are managing it. No, we are not doing that. But that's a very good question, because it's a real problem. So what we are doing for the next product is exactly that.
So at the moment, if I point to something in the cloud up there, and I'm using a version of the compiler, it'll pull it down, and then it'll just fail to compile, because the code I pulled down fails to compile.
Yeah, the question is, if you depend on some code there in Biicode, and then it is being retrieved, and you try to build it with a different compiler, maybe not compatible, you are building in Windows, for example, and it's POSIX-only code, then it will fail. And you will not know it in advance. Of course, we had plans to add all that meta information to the system, but it's not very pragmatic. So we are doing a different approach. I will finish my talk with that approach. So check the update. Okay, what happened if I run bfind and then I find some of the dep libraries and they're going to change widely? I don't want that, right? So actually, what we have here, we have a file. You can check in your project that we have a file here. And you can define here your find policies. So here I'm defining, okay, so for me, for any project I do, I can find dev versions. But for the rest of the people, I will only find stable versions. Okay. So this is syntax is very simple. You can change it, and when you run bfind, for example, you will typically trust your colleagues alpha or beta versions. So you can just write here your colleague, Rdisk alpha, for example, and then you will find those updates. Yeah. What happens, for example, if we have a high variability on releases? That happens. You have OpenCV, for example. You have the branch, the 2.4 branch, the 3.0 beta branch, and they evolve in parallel. So if you want to release to Biicode versions, one after the other, it's going to be a mess. This is going to be 2.4, then 3, then a fix to 2.4. So we have to have a mechanism, something, to make different releases. So we call them tracks. So I'll show you, for example, now I'm in this project. I will show you another functionality here. I've detected a bug, and I'm not the original author, for example, of that library. So I can just, let me check Deps. Okay. So I can just open the thing I'm depending on, okay, so I open it, it's going to be retrieved to my project, so I can actually modify it. Here, now I have a copy inside my project, so I can actually modify it. Let's say I don't like it. This here, so I can build my project. I am now building with the local copy I have inside my project. Let's check it's working. Okay, it seems it's working. And now imagine that I'm not the author of this library, but I want to depend on it. So I want to publish it to Biicode again, so I can change between the original author and my track one. Okay, so I can do that. Sorry, is here. No, sorry, here. If I change my parent information here of the block I've just opened, I'm going to create a track. Just change its name. Minus one means that there is still no version of this track published there in Biicode. Okay, so I just change this number. If I try to publish here, it will complain, because now I have two blocks inside my project. The original one, okay, I was building, and then the one that I have bring into my project. So I can publish the track. Okay, that's it. And actually, I can go now, remove it. Remove it is just simply delete the folder, out the folder. Okay. So now I'm building against the copy I've made in Biicode. I will check here. I have two different, in reality, and there are two different blocks. Well, I have a block, it's called CPP now, and the other block, a different one, is CPP now plus. Okay. So now in my project, I can just switch between them. Now, if I want to return back to the old dependency, I just write the other block. That's it. So this is very useful, for example, when the mainstream, the upstream author won't merge your pull requests, for example, to the mainstream, then you can maintain your own copy for your own purposes. Okay. It's equivalent to a fork, of course, in GitHub, but in our system. We just didn't want to name a fork because it's very related to source control, so we named them tracks.
Does it remember the history on your server of where you came from?
No. The question is if the tracks are remembering the history of where it came. No. We also have a graph of parentship and everything, and we could track it. But it was too complex, and after all, it was not used. So finally, we remove it. So because actually, you want to track it in GitHub, for example, it will typically be a fork of the project in GitHub, and you want to publish it to Biicode, but not to the main author Biicode account. So then you fork in GitHub, you get the relationship there. And then you publish with a different name to Biicode. It's basically a different name. Okay. I'm not going to show this in practice because doing this setup is a little bit more complicated and we will need some time. But in your requirements, you can define things like, for example, you can overwrite dependencies. If you are here downstream and you depend on a library, let's call it B, version 8, that explicitly requires a A version 1, but you actually want to depend on A3. Then you just write here in your requirements, and it will overwrite upstream the dependency. It's typically it's the same as Maven. It works like as Maven. And also, if you have conflicts here, actual conflicts, you can just resolve the conflict, specifying which version do you want to depend on. So you downstream in your project, you explicitly write the requirement, and it will propagate upstream until it reaches the conflict and it will solve it. Okay. So are we? Yeah, it's fine. We have also other cool features. For example, we can depend on cmake files. So you can publish a bunch of cmake recipes and scripts and whatever. And if you want to reuse those scripts in your own projects, you just have to include with in your cmake list file, just write this, and it will be a dependency. You will check that in Bdeps it's unresolved. You can bfind it. You can write your requirements also. And so you can depend on cmake files. So it's very useful for not repeating your cmake scripts everywhere. In fact, we use them, for example, C++ 11 is not as simple as I saw before, because in every platform it's different. If you want to change the stdlib library, in Mac, in Linux, Clang, whatever, it's not exactly the same. So, for example, we have a macro here, a cmake macro. It's called Activate C++ 11, and we use it in our project. So you just include the tool and reuse the macro as if it were in your project, but it's not in your project. It's been retrieved from another project. Okay, this is actually what we are using right now with Boost, because we couldn't manage to publish Boost to Biicode, because it is too large. It has some cyclic dependencies, I think. Okay, so we couldn't manage it. Use of course B2 is a different build system, not CMake. There was an attempt to use CMake, but there actually is not. So what we did is a hook. It's a CMake script that managed to retrieve build boost actually in a transparent way for the user. Then we also have like data dependencies. You can explicit dependencies to other files, not source code files. For example, images. If you want to link an image to your source code, you can do it in your configuration files. And when you retrieve the source code, it will retrieve the image also. So finally, for loading textures and resources for computation and graphicals and things like that, you can do it. Yeah, I think I had a couple of examples there, but I'm not going to. I think I will try the Arduino one. Here you have the repository here. It's a typical serum queue with Google protocol buffers, and it's quite simple to build it with Biicode. I've tried to do it with people, especially in Windows, for example. Building this in Windows without Biicode can take a while, because you have to clone repositories, build things, configure your project, and you waste a lot of time. With Biicode, it can be quite simple. It is the repository there. If any of you want to try and fail something, just ask me. Okay. What I'm going to show you then is this example. It's git. Sorry, HTTP. Yeah, thank you. HTTPS. Yeah. So, for example, this is a project that uses This is a project that uses a GLFW. It's a wrapper, a Windows manager for OpenGL. It's a model replacement for FreeCloud. Right. Yeah, of course I have to run bfind. Yeah, so it has a dependency to GLFW. for a graphic window. I will show you now. And it also has a test, okay, a test built with Google test. I will run the... Well, while it builds, I will show you the code. So here, what I'm building is an average filter for a noisy signal, okay, typical for Arduino, capturing a sensor, whatever. So this is a mobile average filter here. It's very simple C++ code. Of course, it will be probably bad C++ code, but it works, okay? So I'm running. Okay, so I can run the application here, simulate some input, simulate some noise, and then apply the filter, and it seems it is working, so my filter, it's okay. I also have a test here, built with Google test. Okay, and I can run the test, and everything seems okay, right? Then I can, okay, so my project is working. I don't have to worry about packaging anything, I just published it. And now I'm going to build a different Arduino project. Wait. I think I didn't delete the... let me check. Yeah, it's from my last try. I'm just going to delete it. It's going to be a miracle if I finish without any crash or anything, any demo effect here. Yeah. So I published everything with the Google test, with the GLFW code, everything to this blog, right? Now, I'm going to build a new project. It's called Median Reuse. Right. This is just a helper to create a... And then... So here I have the typical Arduino code, right? I can just include here my median filter, right? Okay, it found it, it's retrieving it. And now I can just build it. I think I have to define my settings. Okay, SDK, say the UNO port, I don't have Arduino. Then I change, we are using cmake tool change here. We have tool change for Arduino, for Raspberry Pi.
Some sort of auto configuration for tool chains and stuff. Or the user needs to have a kind of a proper Arduino tool chain.
The question is that it Biicode come with tool chains pre-configured, and the answer is yes for Arduino, for example. We also have a tool chain for Raspberry Pi, for Linux. But for example, the actually, and we have of course the cmake. Hook to apply a toolchain. We have it. But for any toolchains, the best thing is to let the user write the toolchain. In fact, for example, for Windows, I have a toolchain. You got it installed opening a block. So I've just wrote a toolchain, published to Biicode. If you want to use that toolchain in your project, you just open my block, build it, and then you will get the toolchain and you will get all the tools installed in your computer. To build Raspberry Pi in Windows, for example. So we have the places to hook the tool chain, and then you can write your own. We have four, that is Arduino and.
It comes in a wrapper folder, like it's wrapped. Folder structure, or it goes and overrides your default tool chains and stuff.
Yeah, the question is if the tool chains, where are they located and how they are managed in Biicode. So they are inside here, the folders that the Biicode is creating. There are some, for example, here you can find the Arduino tool chain. Oh, the fonts are going to get bigger. So here you get the tool chain. So this is what Biicode is doing. It is pre-configured, but you can also use your own. So if you just locate your tool chain inside this folder, and you use it with bconfigure dash t and the name of your toolchain, it will load the toolchain.
Oh, yeah. I wanted to ask because it might be simpler for kind of early like users, like students, they can use this and have the toolchain. Because the toolchain for a non-computer science guy can be very complicated.
Yeah, the question is that it can be useful for students, because for students, these kind of things are quite complicated. And the answer is yes, but that was one of our mistakes. As we were professors, we focused a lot in the past on students. But there is a problem here, a problem for us, for Biicode as a company. For example, you cannot reach students easily to know you, because they are not in the forums, they are not in Twitter, they are not looking for something like Biicode to solve their problems. They will just attach to the Arduino environment. They don't know the question to ask. So they will not Google for it.
They don't know what to Google.
Yeah, exactly. So they don't know what to Google, exactly. So, and then also, our first working version was Arduino. Biicode worked much better in the past than with typical C++. Because it is simpler, but we realized that we will do nothing as a business, for example. It's a lot of hobby and everything. And also students is a very complicated target. So we decided so we support Arduino and other targets, but it's not our main goal right now. Yep.
The cmake toolchain files, is there a global place that you can locate those on your system so that whenever you create a Biicode project, you can refer to those? Or are they located always in your...
Yeah, the question if the files that contains the tool chains, the cmake tool chains, if they can be located in your system wide.
Yeah.
No, we can. Now our unit of work is the project, so everything has to be in the project.
Oh.
So, yeah, but what you could do is quite easy. You can write a small hook in Python, for example, that just copy from any place to the project. So that can be easily automated.
Oh, okay. There's global hooks with Biicode.
Yeah. You can write Python hooks that will run every time you build your project, and with that hook you can do anything. It's just Python. You can just move files or do whatever you want.
But can I do the hook on init?
Actually, right. The question is if you can run the hook on binit. No, you can't. You can now run hooks on bbuild, pre, post, I think, but not on init. It should be quite easy to add the functionality. But right now, it isn't. So yeah, so with this, I finished the demonstration of Biicode. Are there any further questions about Biicode at this point?
So what if you don't want to use the cloud?
That's a good question. The question is what happens is if you don't want to use the cloud, or you don't want to use our server. We have released like about 70% of our source code is now open source, MIT license. We will release at some point, probably this summer. We are very overwhelmed capacity, but we will release as soon as we can decouple our sensitive data just the server stuff, password and everything. We will release an open source in-house server so you can run your own server on premises. But actually, this is not our main concern, but this is our main concern. So we will release an in-house server, but for a new product, maybe earlier than the in-house for Biicode. Yeah, but that's a good question. Especially, we have, for example, a lot of requests from countries like Russia that they need an in-house server. They will never rely on the cloud. So yeah.
Well, another example would be financial companies, banks, yeah. Whatever they
yeah.
would
yeah.
want.
Yeah, of course.
To be out
yeah.
on the cloud.
Yeah, of course. So definitely, we want to release an in-house server. It's just we didn't have time enough to manage. Okay.
Does this also manage binaries?
No, not yet. That's a problem. That's what we. Yeah, if Biicode manages binaries, not at the moment. We have several examples. For example, we have a block with S simple fast multimedia layer for games that we. Published binaries to Biicode, and it works on certain platforms. We also have like a F-mode sound library as a pre-compiled binary in Biicode, and it works. But we have, for example, size limits. We are using MongoDB in our backend, and we have size limits, so we cannot store everything we want. So for big projects with lots of files or big binaries, we cannot store them at the moment. So
what about an option to not actually store, but have pointers to where something's found?
Yeah, we could of course. If we could not store the files, but have a pointer, some indirection to the actual storage of that, we could do that. It's just more work. It was not a priority up to now. It's a priority right now. But we are not doing in Biicode, we are doing in the new product. Yeah, so actually it's probably one of our biggest constraints is ability to actually handle binaries, large binaries, in a consistent manner with the source code.
Yeah. So what about performance, kind of thousands of files?
Yeah. So what happens with performance for projects with thousands of files?
What's the trend, for example, you mentioned that for Boost, you don't handle that well. So what's the trend if you want to handle Boost?
Yeah, so the question is how to handle Boost, for example, with thousands of files. Yeah. Yeah. As I told, we cannot handle Boost right now. So for us, our approach would be, we want pre-built Boost releases, and we want to be able to fall back to build from source. So that's the approach we are actually doing with, it's called Packet. Our code name is Packet. So what we are building right now is this, actually for managing projects like Boost. Like Boost, OpenCV, Qt, Seagull, all these big projects, and that is typically a pain to build them because they are so large. So you want to rely on binary precompiled artifacts. So what we are doing here is called Packet. We are going to provide a service here similar to Biicode for free for open source project. But we'll also release the code so it can be run in-house, and also it can be run by any other providers. Okay, it will actually not store the code or the artifacts, so you will be able to read them from GitHub or whatever. It will be, of course, multi-platform, and it will be open source from the beginning, the full stack. Okay, so this will address many of the limitations of now we have in Biicode. So basically, the idea is something like this. Great. Do you use Homebrew? I guess so, Mac people.
I was going to say that.
Yeah. So the idea is very similar to Homebrew. So we are building our site here. It's going to be in Python. I think most of us, who prefers Python over Ruby?
I
Who
never used Ruby, so there you
yeah.
go.
Yeah. So actually, we are building the recipes in Python, and it's going to be a recipe. A recipe when you can specify the version, you can specify the source code origin. You can have, for example, conditional requirements, something that people is asking for in Biicode. Okay, I want to depend on this library if I'm in Windows, but none otherwise. So you will be able to build this in these recipes. So we will use all of our knowledge about transitive dependencies, conflict resolution, and all that stuff to build from these recipes. And then, of course, you will have to wrap your build. So we won't interfere anymore with the build system. You will be able to use your cmake, enscons, makefiles, whatever. The only thing you have to do is equal to homebrew, just to wrap it and to define your logic here. If you have Visual Studio solution files and you want to launch them in your recipe, it's fine. Just check here. If you are in Windows, launch this MS build here, and it will build this artifact. And what we are doing here is, okay, so you have the recipe to build things, and then every configuration, every operating system, compiler, every option, possible option, static shared library, everything, it will define a different binary artifact, of course. So what we can do is, okay, we can manage that. We can manage from this recipe, you will have n binary artifacts with different options. So the normal behavior is, okay, I want to depend on Boost 2.0. If these are my settings, I'm working in Visual Studio, I want a shared library, I want this, and I want that. If it finds those options, it finds a pre-compiled binary, it will get it, and it will link against it. And otherwise, it will launch the recipe with your options. And then you will have a binary artifact in your machine. If you want to contribute back the binary, or you want to upload to your in-house server, you will be able to. So, okay, I build it, it works. I can push to any remote. I can push to my office remote. I can push to the packet cloud remote. And there will be the concept like a pull request. So you can tell the original recipe author, okay, I've built this with these options. Do you want to approve it? You want to test it? Do you want to prove it? And if the original author approves it, then consumer of that recipe will automatically be able to use that precompiled binary. So we will kind of manage the different binaries for different systems in one unified, unique platform. Yeah?
Would the recipes, will they be able to handle cross-compiling? So there's a separation between what the host OS is and the target OS is?
Yeah. The question is if the recipes will be able to handle cross-building. Yeah, because they are Python scripts. You can do whatever you want. You will be able to define your own options. For example, here you have the options. So if you want to define options, cross build for Arduino or cross build for everything, and you want to launch a different build script here, you will be able. And if you define here an option saying Raspberry Pi or Arduino support, for example, we will hash that option and it will generate a different artifact. So
in the script you write, it's settings.os equals Windows.
Yeah.
But which OS are you referring to, the target OS or the host OS?
You would, yeah, the question is, here we have some settings, and the settings are saying that is Windows. This is referring to the target OS or to the host OS. You will define it. Settings are your settings. You are providing with the settings to the system. So you will tell the system. So you can configure it as you want. You can use your settings as your machine settings, and you can define an option tailing cross-building to this other operating system, so you will be able to manage it. So what we have learned is you cannot be you cannot pretend to do many things or to be very intelligent. Biicode in the past it tried to do everything, absolutely everything, and it doesn't work that way. So here, well, we are trying to be very flexible. Just we provide with a mechanism of settings, options, and variables. We will hash the combination of them, and we will generate a different artifact based on that hash. And if that hash is repeated in other another consumer of the library, you find the same hash, you will get the same binary. But the hash, you can it's up to you.
But how does Biicode know to when it goes and requests that packet? How does it know to map the settings from what you've currently configured your cmake to what packet settings need to be? So I've configured my cmake with a host and target. How does it know to map it to whatever what settings refer to host and
yeah.
target?
Yeah.
Is there a way to do that?
Yeah, the question is if how do you map from your project your settings and everything to the packet system, and how do you tell you want that option for what dependency is in packet? Is that the question?
Yeah.
Okay, so we are currently defining that. So now we are running with a file, or you can just provide JSON to the command line. And you will say, okay, so my settings are this. And you will just explicitly define everything. So if you want to use a configuration file in your project and telling, okay, for OpenCV, I want this option on. For whatever, Boost, I want static on. And you will define for every requirement will have their own options. So you can here you can say self requires some library. And here you will be able to split some options of that library.
You want to standardize the option so that that way you can configure it a certain standard way, and then that way, or at least the packet could introspect onto what the cmake settings are, so that it could properly set the build settings, right?
The question is that if we are going to standardize options, so we can more or less handle some pre-configured settings from projects, more or less.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it seems like you'd have to set a setting for host and target for every single library in the environment, which could get very large, rather than taking it straight from, like, say, cmake. It's available in cmake. It can transfer or have settings that you set for what a host and target switch would be.
Yeah. That's the kind of things we have to work right now. It's not solved yet, that part.
Related question to that is macros and defines on the compile line might affect your build and whether something is, say, binary compatible. Have you thought much about that and how that would fit into this?
Yeah. The question is what happens with macros and configuration, everything that runs at build time that changes the way the things is going to be built. We have found here that there are many configurers out there that actually always produce the same output. If you are in Windows 7, the configuration will produce basically the same output. Okay, if you have some variability there, because any other options, the author of the recipe will have to map. Will have to declare what is changing the build. There's no other way. So when you build the recipes, it's like homebrew. You can have a boost with many options, but then the homebrew recipe just declare some of them. A static link with ICU, for example. But there is like four flags, four options you are declaring. So the author of the recipe will have to declare the variability and things that are affecting. And with that options, he will have to inject to the specific build system via environment, flags, over the command line, wherever he will have to inject the actual values of the options. There's no other way to do it in a general way. Yeah. Any other question?
So will the recipes here, will they be moderated by you guys, submitted to a central repository and provided to the end users of packet, or will individuals be writing these recipes and using them on their own systems?
Yeah, the question if the recipes will be moderated by us, where this recipe will live, how will you manage to find them or whatever. No, we won't moderate anything. So here, the our free service will be free. You can write any recipe and you can just push it to the service. You can push also your recipes to your in-house server, or you can run in the cloud your own server, and you will be able to push your recipes everywhere, including our server. So moderation, zero. I don't like the moderation of Homebrew, for example. I understand that that is the way it should be, but I don't like it that much. So we think, or at least it's our belief, that people must be able to just create a recipe, and in 2 minutes it could be there, available for everybody. So you will be able to just be a recipe. We will have users and channels. So for OpenCV, for example, you can write your own recipe and push it to our server, but it will live under your user. And you can also publish the recipes under different channels, like testing or stable or whatever, so you don't affect your users. If there is a packet published there and you want to publish a new version, you can do it without affecting your users. So,
so personally, my experience with Homebrew has been pretty good with their moderated recipes, just because oftentimes when I want to use a library, I'm not really interested in configuring it to the level of detail that a lot of other people would. So, you know, brew install, GCC 4.8 or something like that. And having a default recipe available that I know has at least been used by a lot of other people is pretty handy. But then in Homebrew, you can also the verb they use is tap, but you can source to another repository and use recipes from that.
Mm-hmm.
People do that to host their own recipes.
Yeah, like Homebrew Cask, for example.
Cask, right. And I guess just thinking about having a centralized repository of the really popular recipes, I feel like that would increase the adoption rate and allow people to contribute like that. Then it doesn't necessarily require vendor buy-in for Boost, for example.
Yeah. So the point there is that moderation is good for some use cases, and because you can actually rely on it, you know that it has been moderated and it works. So our approach right now is we could, of course, validate users. We can certify, for example, that the one that has uploaded the Boost recipe is actually the Boost committee, for example. We can do that. We can also rely on crowd knowledge. So if we have metrics for everything and you have a recipe that is being used by many, many people, you know that it's working. And also you have the statistics of the pre-compiled binaries that are not only their recipe, but only the binary that is being used for other users. So maybe crowd knowledge can also work fine for this purpose. We don't know yet. Maybe we can do like approved users is good kind of moderation, would be basically the same as moderation, very close. We can moderate, or we can just use crowd knowledge. At the moment, we haven't decided for anything. I mean, we will just roll out the technology first, and let's learn how users are using it and what are they requesting. Especially if the original authors, for example, the Boost people, is interested in this service. I mean, our main goal here is to have something that is really useful, for example, for releasing Boost. So I don't have to release to download Boost anymore. I don't know if it's in SourceForge, Boost pre-compiled releases. Are they in SourceForge anymore? No.
I know they migrated their source to get, but
But the binaries, precompiled binaries?
Binaries from source
forge. Yeah.
I think those are related issue to the one you were saying about how do you know what's good and what's bad. Is if you look at GitHub, you know, people manage to find the good stuff on GitHub without, there's no moderation there,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The wheat and the chaff gets separated pretty quickly then.
I think initially, this is our approach. The question. So the point there is that GitHub is working without moderation, and there can be hundreds of forks of a project, and people is actually able to find the good one and use that good one. Or even if the original author doesn't maintain anymore, they will move to a different fork, and they will keep rolling a different fork. So this is a non-moderation approach that is working. So we like it. But we don't know yet.
It might be worth considering encouraging parameterized builds for those recipes as opposed to putting the configuration directly in the recipe, providing the configuration to the recipe, just so that recipes could be, you know, really reusable. You know, you define it like that. Just a thought.
Yeah, so the thought that is if we could make some pre-configured good practices for recipes.
Yeah.
So we can do this, sure. Actually, what we are doing is we think that in 4-6 weeks we were able to have a proposal. So any of you that are interested, please write me, because I would love you to try it out and contribute, and maybe in two months it will be full open source for everybody. So if you want to join the trial and help to fine tune these things, I would love to. So this is my main purpose today here is this one. So yeah, I agree that good practices, somewhat code in recipes that could be reused to make new recipes could be great, but still there are still too many things to solve, like the one that the Paul said that are most important right now is the priorities for the minimum viable product. Okay, and yeah, it's time to go. If you have any other question, just talk to me.